He will forever be known as the 9/11 hijacker who deliberately crashed United Flight 93 into a field in Pennsylvania. This video, seen here for the first time, appears to confirm that Ziad Jarrah was prodded along by Al-Qaeda. Jarrah frequently stumbles through his own martyrdom tape, can't maintain a serious tone. His Al-Qaeda handlers coach him to be more dramatic. Start again, one of them scolds him off camera. This speech requires passion. Why don't you try a different approach? A second man chimes in.
This is not reality jihadism. This is more, in fact, scripted.
Flight 93, hijacker Ziad Al-Jarrah, whose first cousin, Ali Al-Jarrah, was later busted in Lebanon as a spy for Israel.
Ali Al-Jarrah, Mossad spy for 25 years, is Ziad Al-Jarrah's first cousin. He was busted and aspiring in Lebanon. Jarrah's passport was found slash planted from Flight 93.
Ziad Jarrah's family hasn't heard from him for a week. They hope he's alive, but fear he's dead. An innocent victim, they say, in the 757 jet that crashed in Pennsylvania last Tuesday. What they can't accept is the very thing the FBI has suggested, that Ziad Jarrah was part of a conspiracy to murder thousands.
The last time he called, talking to his father as usual, laughing, making jokes on the phone, we are living on the hope that our Ziad Jarrah is not the one who was on the plane.
But you haven't heard from him?
We haven't heard from him.
For the past 2 days, the Jarrah family has been receiving guests, not in mourning, they insist, believing it may still be that Ziad wasn't aboard the hijacked plane. They simply dismiss the suggestion that he was involved in the hijacking conspiracy.
It's not the typical picture of someone...
It's not the typical picture of a religious person.
Or of a religious terrorist in this case.
If he's not a religious person, then he couldn't be in any way a religious terrorist.
Certainly, Ziad Jarrah's background from his family's description suggests nothing sinister. From a well-off middle-class family with relatively liberal views, educated at Christian schools, pursuing a career in aviation at a German university.
Was he a religious extremist?
No. He was leading very, very normal life.
Had he ever been to Afghanistan?
No.
Been suggested?
No.
Ziad's uncle, Jamal Jarrah, is currently a deputy in the Lebanese parliament and a member of the Future Movement, a pro-Saudi political party that has important media presence in Lebanon and internationally. Unlike the late Times 2009 article on Ali Al-Jarrah's arrest, which attempts to marginalize his family connection to Ziad, an early connection from 2008 in the Lebanese Daily Star was a bit more blunt and found this family link worthy to title Members of Israeli Spy Ring Related to 9/11 Hijacker, which also details that he was arrested along with a brother, Yusuf, and appears that Ali was considered a valued spy, sending reports and taking clandestine photographs of Palestinian groups and Hezbollah.
This is the mobile phone footage Iran says shows the immediate aftermath of the bombing that killed a senior Hezbollah commander in Syria.
On the night of February 12th, 2008, Imad Mughniyeh walked out of a restaurant. Mughniyeh had no idea, but two CIA officers were watching him, and they relayed the information to the Mossad in Tel Aviv. When he walked by an SUV that blew up and killed him, the Mossad came to the CIA, possibly as early as 2006, and said, "We found Mughniyeh. It was a marriage of convenience." I'm told that the Israelis wanted to pull the trigger because it was a matter of revenge. The CIA in the US isn't associated with using car bombs to kill terrorists. I think some experts would say that is something terrorists do. Something criminal gangs do.
It's reported that Ali gave the information and identification to the assassination of Mughniyeh. Mughniyeh also spent 6 months in a clinic for cosmetic surgery in the mid-90s, making himself unrecognizable. Ali Al-Jarrah also had a second wife he kept secret who lived in a cheap apartment near the Syrian border, which must have certainly paid off for Israeli intelligence, as it was revealed in Ask Safir newspaper that with Ali's arrest in 2008, he had testified that months prior he had scouted certain points on the coastal town of Qortus in northern Syria. where Israeli Shayet 13 naval commandos assassinated General Mohammed Soleiman, President Bashar al-Assad's special advisor for arms procurement and strategic weapons, at his beach home on the Mediterranean.
A top Syrian general who served as the country's liaison officer to Hezbollah was shot dead by a sniper in the Syrian port city of Tartus on Friday. Sources in Damascus said that General Mohammed Soleiman was a key orchestrator in the sharing of nuclear information and technology between Iran, Syria, and North Korea. According to reports, he was also responsible for securing the Syrian Al-Kibar nuclear reactor, which was destroyed in an Israeli airstrike last year.
It wasn't until 2015 that a National Security Agency document leaked by Edward Snowden revealed that Israeli commandos were indeed behind Soleiman's assassination.